we are being filmed tonight, as you've probably noticed. If any of you want to ask a question but really, really don't want to appear on camera, then either hide behind a pillar or ask us to switch that off, because that is your right. Okay, so again, don't feel hindered because you don't want to appear. And I understand some of that footage, at least, will probably be going on social media, will it not? So, again, if you don't want the risk of your face appearing, please ask us and we'll switch that off. When it does come to questions from the floor, I will be running around with the radio mic, so please don't speak until everybody can hear you. I'm hoping there aren't too many questions on the balcony, or I might leave the NHS by the end of the evening. Councillor Steve Smith has just asked for me to give a notice, and that's a notice that Sarah Williston, our MP, will be coming to Dartmouth now on Friday the 22nd of June at 6:30 in the Townsville Community Hall, just to give you that date. So that you can go and talk to your MP, or we can talk to our MP if we wish. I think that is everything on my list. And so it's a great pleasure to hand over to Sir Geoffrey Newman, who will be chairing tonight's meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Will. And thank you all for coming tonight, both up in the gallery, choir stall, two sides here. This is a most fantastic turnout from Dartmouth and the district. Well done, you all. Clap yourselves for coming. Brilliant. Well done. As you've heard from Father Will, I've been asked to chair the meeting this evening. But I think you should know, I've never met any of the panel members, except for briefly tonight. And I'm not involved in any of these stakeholder organisations, except as an occasional visitor to the Dartmouth medical practice. But could you please make sure you've switched off your telephones or put it to silent, please, otherwise it rings up there and it's not super. The intention is to finish by 8:30. Okay. But I gather there's a willingness by the members here to hold more sessions in future if needed. Okay, so this isn't the end of the road, everybody. Now, it is perfectly apparent that feelings are running very high about the closure of Dartmouth Hospital and the recent loss of Riverview. And as Father Will has said, please respect each other's views and conduct yourselves with dignity and composure appropriate to this very fine setting. And please allow presenters or those to speak to finish their sessions before interruption. So don't interrupt everyone. Let everyone say what they're going to say so everyone can hear. Now, the panel members. I'd like to introduce you to the panel members. We have Liz Davenport here, who's an interim CEO of Torbay and South Devon Foundation. And we have Simon Tapley here, who's the Director of Commissioning, Devon Clinical Commissioning Group. Thank you very much, Simon. And there's other members in the group here, other experts who may be called upon to give their advice or words when necessary. So we're going to start the proceedings now with a short presentation, starting with Simon Tapley. Simon, over to you.
So I haven't got a problem, right? Oh. Right,
good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for so many people turning out. And thank you for, on behalf of Liz and I, for inviting us tonight. It might not appear like it, but actually we are very grateful to be here, and we're looking forward to listening to all your comments and trying to provide as many answers as we can. So I just wanted to kick off, because I know one of the questions that's come in is about why did the Clinical Commissioning Group, the CCG, make the decision it did? So back in January 2017, we'd completed a consultation. Previous to that, we'd had engagement And we had a governing body meeting. Some of you may have been there. I think Dee was there. Certainly Dr. Wollaston was there, at least another race course. We went through all of the feedback from the public we'd had over 2,000 responses. We took through the governing body all of those items, and we agreed at that meeting to go through with the changes to the models of care that we've been speaking to you all about. Now, what we said was, in terms of making those changes, there would be some gateways to make sure that before the trust and other providers could actually start to make those changes, there were some gateways required. And particularly for Dartmouth, those were that we recruited to the intermediate care team or the community-based service that we talked to you all about. That there were as a safe home for outpatient services to be provided, and that we could secure enough beds to meet the needs of the population. So when we, Liz and colleagues presented to us at the evidence, they presented that they'd recruited the right number of community staff. I think that is still true today, and Liz can go into a bit more detail. The outpatient services would move to Dartmouth Clinic, and again, that's still operational now with physio and various other services. And that we had a block contract arrangement, four beds with the ability to flex to six at Riverview Nursing Home. So we know those circumstances have changed, but when we made those decisions collectively with the Trust, all of those gateways have been met. So I think it's really important. I know there's been, and we are expecting it to be quite an emotional evening, but I think it's really important that we remember when we made those decisions, all of those gateways have been met, and there was evidence to be provided to us for that.
Simon, thank you very much indeed. I think we'd like to hear from Liz now, please.
Good evening. So, can you hear me? So I'm, as I say, Liz Davenport. I'm the interim chief executive of Torbay. Can't hear it.
Use this one.
Never was very good with technology, so apologies for that. So again, like Simon said, I work for Torbay South Devon Foundation Trust. I'm the interim chief executive, and I'm pleased to be here today because we believe it's really important that we listen to and work with our local community. We've seen a lot of change, haven't we, in the last year on the back of the consultation process and the decisions that were made this time last year. We have seen the development of our community services, including our intermediate care services, and increasing our community staff. And that's enabled us to do a lot more to support people at home than we were able to do this time last year. And I'm sure we'll get into the detail of that as we respond to questions later on. We have had a huge disappointment, though, haven't we? Because we had intended that we would be able to deliver those health and wellbeing services, which are being delivered in the local community, but we had anticipated and hoped that that would be located into one central hub in a building called Riverview. And we weren't able to conclude that process. So that health and wellbeing centre, although it absolutely remains our commitment to this community and we intend to deliver on it, is going to take longer than we expected because we were unable to complete that. And we share your disappointment. I'm personally very disappointed that has not been achieved in the way that we had agreed to. Our time here today is to listen to questions and respond. I have brought a team of people both from the Trust and from Devon County Council. So if we are not able to respond specifically to some of the questions, I'm hoping that some of my colleagues will be able to do so. If there's anything that we can't answer directly today, then we will take it away and make sure that we come back and provide you with a detailed response in due course. But with that in mind, I think we'll probably just move over to questions.
Liz, thank you very much. Okay, now. The panel are now going to answer a number of questions which have been put together, and they have not had sight of these questions at all, so it will be straight from the mouth here. And John Mitchell, I would be grateful if you could please say your question, please.
Good evening. My question is in two parts. On a scale of 1 to 9, with 9 being very significant, how important as a perceived financial valuation of the former Dartmouth Hospital site been in the decision-making so far? And which organisation would benefit from the sale proceeds?
So John's got two questions here, okay? And I'm just giving a moment for them to get their thoughts together. So on a scale of 1 to 9, and with 9 being the most significant, how important has the perceived financial valuation of the former Dartmouth Hospital site been in the decision-making so far? Question 2 is coming up in a minute.
So if I talk loudly, will you be able to hear me, or do I need to wait? Sorry, I was just asking if you could hear it clearly, clearly not. So, apologies, can you hear me now?
No! Can you hear me? Well, okay. So, yes, you can hear me now, I can hear me now. So, to answer your question, so on a scale of 1 to 9, how significant was the sale proceeds? 1. So, not significant at all. And that's fine, I recognise you may not agree with that, but that's the honest answer.
The second question was, which organisation would benefit from the sale process?
So in terms of the sale of Dartmouth Hospital, the proceeds from Dartmouth Hospital will go into enabling us to fund health and wellbeing centres for our communities. So all of the changes that we have made in terms of our estate is to enable us to realise the financial benefit to reinvest in properties which are fit for purpose in the longer term.
Right. There will be questions to answer. You'll have a chance afterwards to ask the questions. But take note of what they're saying now, because you want to get that in your mind so when you ask the question, you've got it right there, okay? So make sure you do that. Don't interrupt now. We've got lots more questions to go. All very pertinent. David Leonard, please have your question. Where's David Leonard? Yeah. David Leonard, microphone, please. You've got a chance to ask it again later on. Right, David Leonard, please could you ask your question?
Ready? My question is...
David, hold on. Those in the gallery up there, if you go on speaking like that, this meeting will...
Why was Dartmouth Hospital closed before replacement facilities were properly in place at Riverview?
David's got another three questions to ask, but I think we should direct that straight now to get an answer of that now.
Okay, so as I said in my opening statement, so we did have a block contract with Riverview at the time when we made that decision. We said there needed to be 3 gateways, as I said. Intermediate care team was fully established, that there were places for outpatients to be provided, and that we had beds. And all of those 3 criteria were fulfilled. Circumstances have changed since, haven't they? So...
No, that's not right.
So I'm just going to say a little bit more about it from a service delivery perspective, because when we made the decision around the way in which services were going to be delivered, we made a commitment to deliver a range of services that will be available to people in the local community. And as Simon's talked about, we said that we would have intermediate care teams, so those would be teams of nurses and therapists and others working alongside our primary care colleagues to support people at home. We also said that we would have access to domiciliary care services and that we would have intermediate care beds to be supported locally. And we agreed that those things would be put in place and available to the local community at the point at which we made the decision to close the hospital. What we were very clear about at the time, though I know it's a point of disappointment for the community, is we knew that we weren't able to deliver bringing that into one building at that point in time. What we said is that we would seek to negotiate the delivery of that one purpose-built unit that brought together our primary care colleagues, our intermediate care services, our local nursing teams, the voluntary sector, and the nurse into one building. I mean, you at the point at which that we made those changes, that will take us some time to deliver. And as I said, we expected to be able to do that much more quickly than we've been able to do because we were in positive conversation with the owner of that provider. But at the point at which we made the decision to close the hospital, we were really clear that we'd provide those services, but we were not at that point in time able to put them into one building. And our aspiration remains to deliver that in one building, and we are actively pursuing the delivery of that. But at the point in time, it wasn't something that we made a commitment to at the point at which those changes were made.
Liz, thank you very much. You've got another question.
Nonetheless, having listened to that, the decision by the Trust and the CCG to close the hospital prematurely looks to me to be negligent.
We understand that feelings are running really high in relation to the hospital, but the focus that we have been bringing to our service is delivering something which is much more about supporting people at home. And in fact, as a result of the changes that we... Can I just finish this a minute? I'm quite happy to answer more questions, but if I can just finish. The intention was to provide much more support to people at home, and we've been able to do that. So we've been able to, at this point in time, we've got more than 200 people in the Dartmouth area that are being actively supported by our community teams. We've been able to support more people at the end of their lives in their homes than we were able to do before. We've been working much more proactively and engaging with our voluntary sector colleagues to provide those support networks at home. All of those things we would not have been able to do if we maintained the service model that we had before. So I understand the hospital was very, very much loved by the local community. But the future is about supporting people more at home. And that's what we've been able to do as a consequence of the changes we've put in place. We acknowledge that not being able to deliver that in one central point is something that we'd hoped to do earlier than we have done. But the outcome of the changes we've been made have enabled us to do much more for people in their own homes than we were able to do before. And I think the stories that go alongside that are powerful in themselves. And a number of people here would be able to describe them, but we are being able to support people to remain with their families, even when they have really quite significant ill health at home. And that is what we aspired to do and what the consultation process was all about.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you very much, Liz. Hold on, there are questions a bit later. Please, David, another one.
I'd like to know by what democratic process the decision to close the hospital was taken. How can we appeal against it? And shouldn't those who made this decision be now considering their position with a view to resigning?
So, as I said earlier, we required evidence from the Trust around the gateways that were in place. I won't go through those again, those three things. The CCG has a governing body which has GPs on it, lay members, and also executives. Executives are appointed by NHS England, which is the national governing body of the NHS commissioning side. And with the Trust, we've made those decisions. In terms of democratic process, the consultation process went through the overview and scrutiny committee of Devon County Council, and was deemed to be a good process.
Okay, Sam, thank you very much. Okay, there's questions, later. Working on it. No, so can I call upon Phil Brackenberg, Dr. Phil Brackenberg, please? Questions, please, then.
Hi, Sir Geoffrey. My question is, which organisation exactly is responsible for commissioning beds, community beds in the Dartmouth area?
I'm going to stop you there. Can you answer that question now, please?
So the clinical commissioning group is responsible for assessing the needs of the population and making sure those needs are met. Some of that in terms of, so that would be a global macro level. In terms of individual commissioning beds, compared to that's devolved to the trust at an individual level.
Your second question,
please. So the trust is the body responsible for commissioning those beds?
Indeed.
The second part of that question is, what is the breakdown of those beds, rehab, step-down, intermediate care, etc.? And the third part of the question is, how close to Dartmouth do those beds have to be provided?
Just picking up on Simon's earlier comments, so in terms of the configuration of our beds and how they're organised, that is a responsibility of the trust. But also, beds are delivered in a number of different ways. Some are hospital-based beds, but we also work very closely with them and County Council, who also have responsibility for some of the nursing and residential care beds that we have in our community. In terms of our breakdown, this is one of my I'm going to hand over to my colleague Dawn Butler, who will be able to tell us a little bit more about the numbers of beds that apply to this particular locality. Dawn, I hand over to you. Hello everybody. So there are a number of different ways in which we provide bed-based care to the people who live in Dartmouth and in the surrounding area. One of those settings is in care homes, and we use both residential care homes and also nursing care homes to look after people for a very short period of time whilst they are getting better and receiving active rehabilitation, which means that they're receiving support from our NHS and social care teams to become more mobile and to regain their confidence and to become more independent. That's really important to support people to have the confidence to continue to live in their own homes. So over the last year, we have needed to support people to access care homes under intermediate care. We've needed to support 33 people in total. Of those people, 14 in the last year needed to access nursing care home beds because of the support needs that they had, then those nursing beds were needed for them. So in the last year, that was 14 people and 33 overall. Actually, we supported many more people under intermediate care, but the vast majority of those people are supported at home with our social workers, our community nurses, our occupational therapists, our physiotherapists, our pharmacists, our GPs, our reimbursement teams. To also answer your question about bed-based care, we also use community hospital beds as well, and we have community hospital beds available to people in Totnes, in Dawlish, in Brixham. The vast majority of people, so in terms of how many beds people have used community hospital beds in the last year, so 82 people in Dartmouth in the last year have needed a community hospital bed and access to community hospital beds. One of those people, 6 people, were supported in our specialist stroke unit in Newtonborough Hospital. That is where we provide the specialist environment for people who have experienced a stroke to get better. And 75 people have accessed rehabilitation beds, which are also supported as medical beds in our community hospitals. 44 of those people have accessed that support in Totnes, and 23 have accessed that support in Newtonborough.
Right, thank you very much. Right, okay. Questions later, but can I have a Sue Preston, please? Sue Preston's got a question. Where's there you are? Still over there. There you are. Over there. Sue Preston.
Good evening. Because of our geographical position, ambulances can take many hours to reach patients. One took 7 hours. This was for a critically ill patient who sadly died a couple of days later.
Now, this is,
this, oh, yes, is this acceptable?
Yeah, right. Thanks, Sue. Yeah.
So, short answer, no, it's not, because 7 hours is not an acceptable time.
time for critical ambulance to be picking people up? Absolutely not. So we do work very closely with South West Ambulance Trust. And that, no, that's not, and that's, we need to do more work with them. But that's an outlier, that's an exception, isn't it? 7 hours.
50 minutes for our friends having a heart attack last year.
Thank you very much, thank you very much. Right, okay, questions, get them ready. A lot of questions here. Kathy Cathcart, where are you? There, Kathy's right here.
Why can Carver Cottage Hospital be reopened and updated to an acceptable standard while a solution is found? And part of that, the minor injuries unit is an essential for a town with an ageing population, which has more than 1 million visitors every year, and a much used river where boating accidents can take place. We feel it's imperative that the minor injuries unit is close to the waterfront for obvious reasons and should be part of the hospital.
So Dawn just read out the detail. So we had 75 people went to community hospitals. That's give or take 1.5 beds a week. That's what we would have needed, 75 people. So you know that we need to make sure that we have commissioned the right level of beds that meet the needs of the population. And 75 beds, 75 people is quite a low number. But Liz will answer some of the details.
So I'm going to start by just saying, talking a little bit about the community hospital. So as we've been talking about today, the whole focus of the work that we've been doing is providing more community support to enable more people to work. If I could just finish and then I'm happy to pick up, of course I am. So the care model changes that we consulted on were all about us providing more care and support to people at home. And we have been doing that work, and we know already that we have increased significantly the number of people who are supported at home. In fact, over 200% more people are supported at home. As a consequence of that, fewer people need to go into an inpatient bed, as Simon's talked about. Because we've had those alternative arrangements in place, we've been able to support more people at home. And it is for those reasons that we don't believe that having a hospital with 18 beds in this community is the right thing to do. And it's a difficult choice. It's a difficult choice for us. We've got a certain amount of resources available for us to meet the needs of our community now and into the future. And we believed, and we have engaged with a lot of people over a long period of time about what we believe that model could best deliver. And that has been about supporting more people at home. That's what a lot of people talk about. In terms of the minor injuries, again, as part of the decision that was made following the consultation in January 2017, a decision was made to locate our minor injuries units in a smaller number of places. There was a number of reasons for that. Partly it was the pattern of how people use services, and also how we were able to use our very scarce resource, including radiographers. And that was the decision that was made. What we did agree for the local community is that the minor injuries service, or support for people who have cuts and bruises that happen in everyday life, that we would work in collaboration with our primary care colleagues and provide some additional capacity. Now, I've talked to our GP colleagues today, and probably some of the communication around that could have been better, and how we've gone about that. But in terms of the minor injury service, we have followed on that commitment to provide some additional support to deal with what we knew from doing an audit could be meant for in that local community, cuts, bruises, which is what the vast majority of people were accessing that service for.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Chance at coming to give questions. Ray Bridges, your question please. Ray Bridges, where are you?
My heart
Dartmouth Hospital be modified to make it fit for purpose, as you keep saying, as the new health and well-being centre.
Identification of the strategic estate partner, that will be in August of this year.
In terms of the lead-in time for us to have a health and wellbeing centre built, it is not going to be done straight away. But the expectation would be that would be approximately 2021 when that would be completed. What I would stress, what I would stress, the functions of the health and wellbeing centre are being delivered in the community. It's just not in the purpose-built unit that we're aspiring to achieve.
Thank you very much. Now look here. Now, opportunities now. I know there's one lady there wants to speak, and I know there's somebody there. So look, let's do it sensibly. We can't go rushing around with microphones everywhere. One at a time, please. Now, please raise your hand, say who you are, and who you represent, if you are, unless you're representing yourself. One speaker at a time. Please, who's going to start off?
My name is here.
Thank you.
Hi everybody, Lynn Gunnable, I'm a resident here in Dartmouth. I'd like to ask the people here why a decision was made to spend £8 million renting the building for 30 years that we would never ultimately own and get no reinvestment from, as opposed to the £300,000 in the report that said would be needed to bring Dartmouth Hospital up to date.
Somebody please tell me why we can't have a well-being centre with
one, two, five, or 10 beds in the hospital that we own, on the site we own, and which is convenient for the people of Dartmouth and why I moved here.
Stroke. Right, that's great, let's get an answer.
know that Simon talked earlier about the ambulance service, and I know again that's something that the local community have been concerned about, and long times of response times aren't acceptable, and we absolutely understand that. I guess one of the reasons we have been so keen to develop a local community offer is to recognise absolutely what you're describing, is that there is a isolated community, and we are committed to doing much more locally to support more people locally within that community without having to go and access services elsewhere. So, for example, we are seeing far more people in outpatient clinics that are directly delivered in Dartmouth than we were before, so that people have to travel less than they were previously. So we do absolutely recognise that. At an individual level as well, we are committed to make sure that we work with individuals to find out what's important with them, to work with their families to make sure that we have the right support in place for them as an individual. So this is not about one response, it's about making sure that we do the right things for families and do what's important to them.
Right, okay, over here. Lady in the back, and you've seen your hand up frequently. Over there, right over there. There you are, lady. There you are.
Right, Joan King. I have a question for the lady about home care. This is of great concern to many people in Dartmouth. I have had experience of this. It worked quite well to start with, but it got progressively worse. Because the carers didn't come from Dartmouth, they came from Torbay, they came from South Brent, they came in their cars. They couldn't park their cars half the time. They certainly couldn't get here on time. I was left in quite a predicament at time. But eventually things came to a head and I couldn't go home any longer. And my husband, fortunately, is at Beacon House, which is a very nice residential care home here in Dartmouth. Beacon House is nearly full all the time. Now, a lot of these people need 24-hour care. Now, with this home care system we've heard about, I would like to ask the lady, where is she going to find the people who are going to come and do all this caring? With an aging population in Dartmouth, we're going to need more carers. They're nowhere for the carers to park their cars. They don't live here. Most of the young people are out of town, and quite frankly, it's not a career for 17 or 18-year-olds. We've been told, oh yes, we can train the carers. To be a carer has to be someone very special, not just someone who's come out of school with no degrees and no credits.
We do recognise the challenges of bringing people through, and I know that there's been a lot of work being done by the council to extend the contractual arrangement. So if I may, Ian and Lynn, just ask you to say a little bit about that.
Could you just tell everybody who you are?
Yeah, good evening everybody. So my name is Ian Potts, and I'm part of the leadership team for the adult social care service across Devon from the County Council. And I have responsibility for the contract across the whole of Devon actually, which is for the provision of care through people's homes. And I think the first thing I would say is I absolutely agree with the lady that asked the question about the value of care workers. The biggest challenge that we and the agencies that deliver care have is finding those people. It's not a financial issue, actually. The investment that the County Council puts into personal care and the wages that are paid from that is amongst the top prices in the region and even the country. So this is not a financial issue. It is about finding people who want to work in that care industry and who we can support. What I can say to you is that we're very confident that from the beginning of June, everybody in Dartmouth that needs a personal care package will have one. There's not very many people that don't have that now. It's a handful of people at any one time. We very carefully monitor those, but we've extended the contractual arrangements, and there will be provisions at the beginning of June. So we shouldn't have anybody waiting for care at all. So that's, I think, a really positive thing to say. We are working with the personal care agencies around training and development for people, not just within the agencies they work for, but we're working very closely with health and social care services more widely, because I think we think that the way in which you attract people and retain them isn't just about paying them well and valuing them, it's about giving them an opportunity for career development and for a progression in their, over their lifetime, if that's what they want in terms of their lifetime in work. So we're putting a lot of work into that. And you may have seen the Proud to Care campaign information. If you haven't, it's on buses, it's in supermarkets, it's on the website. We're doing everything we possibly can to find care workers. So I suppose all I would finish by saying is that, you know, we can't magic those people up. We can't bust them in from, you know, from Timbuktu.
But we don't want to rely on the invisible people.
They have to come from within the community. So I think, you know, the plea we would make is that if there are people within the Dartmouth community who want to work in that industry, please come forward. And we'll work with you, we'll support you, we'll train and develop you, and we'll try and keep you in the service to help meet the needs of your local people. But they have to come from the local community.
Right, thank you very much, sir. Then again, the lady in the back. I know the lady in the back. I've got you, but I want the lady in red here.
Thank you. Helen Beeson from Save Our Hospital Services in Devon, and I'm here from Totnes, where we still have a community hospital, which actually saved my daughter's life, but unfortunately now we have to share it with all of the South Hams, because that's where you have to go. And I have a question for the panel, the representatives of the CCG and the Trust. When you were told by NHS England back in 2016 that you were not cutting fast enough and put under a capped expenditure programme, you undertook to cut £550 million from budgets by 2021. 590 beds, one in six of the beds across Devon. Since when I understand you've received some awards for the efficiency with which you've now put those cuts into place. And while you think about how proud you feel about those awards, would people like me to read a list of the communities that have lost their community hospitals that are sending their solidarity to the people of Dartmouth through Save Our Hospital Services? Yeah. Ashburton, hey. Axminster, hey. Bindiford, and up to B, Bowie Tracy, Brixham, Budley Salterton, Crediton, Dawlish, Holdsworthy, Honiton, Ilfracombe, Kingsbridge, Moreton Hampstead, Oakhampton, Ottery St Mary, Hayton, Seaton, Torrington, Teanbridge and Whipton. These communities stand in solidarity with the people of Dartmouth in resisting these closures and the impact it will have on you.
Say that we're bursting with hospital beds, we need spare beds. Is there any chance that you can take somebody on? Where is the home, Zia? I mean, we're a residential home, not a nursing home, but some people that need to come home from hospital need 24/7 care. You're not going to get it with the National Health.
Right, thank you very much indeed.
So firstly, I'd just like to say thank you to you. So that, you know, that those sorts of stories we hear from carers all the time, so people have been employed and that work going beyond the call of duty. When I was listening to those stories, I actually came out and spent a day with Dean and with Nick in Dartmouth Caring and met a number of the people that work there and was privileged enough to be able to, like I say, spend the day with them and actually visit some people. I think some of the work that they did was absolutely amazing. I think those are the sorts of things in terms of community buy-in that we really have to build upon. I know Dee was nodding when Ian was talking about how we can find the right people from inside the community to actually help us with this, and in terms of making sure that we've got a good career development for people. That is the only way, that's the only way we're going to be able to be sustainable. But in terms of the beds, so I think we've said before, haven't we, there were 75 people that needed community hospital beds, but we did make 33 placements into residential and nursing homes, 14 into nursing homes. So we actually managed to do that over the last year. That's the numbers that were needed, that's the placements that were needed, and we actually found beds for all of those people. I know every time Liz has said around the increase in terms of intermediate care contacts at home, people have groaned. But I think it is really important that people hear that the vast majority of the people we're now caring for are being able to be cared for at home and safely. And if you listen again to what Ian said, in terms of money has been increased for domiciliary care, and we've just increased the number of hours that we bought on Block 4 Dartmouth, that the vast majority of people are being able to be looked after at home. It's really important to make sure that we hold that. I know that the motion is high, and every time Liz has said that, I've sat in the seat, it's more difficult when you're stood up, but I've sat in the seat and watched, and there are cynical groans when she says that. But it's really important that people are actually being able to be supported at home. But we've only been able to do that because of the changes we've made to the model. So hopefully that does answer. We have been able to do that in terms of finding care home beds for the people that needed them in 1718.
Thank you very much. There's a gentleman right at the back there, right at the back, hand out there. Pam, coming back to you. If you can hand the mic over, just go right, Father Will. Go right there. There you are, look there. Gentlemen there. Put your hand up again, please.
Hello. Hi, I'm Sarah O'Shaughnessy. I'm a local lady and a nurse of 27 years. I run a private care team at the moment, and we're one of the few providers who can still provide funded care through the council and the new frameworks. We actually get paid a little bit less to work in Dartmouth than we do in Kingsbridge these days, which means a lot of people have withdrawn their service from the private sector who are providing care here through funded agencies. And I wonder where the investment Mr. Hobbs was talking about has come from, really, when it's more cost effective for me to have my staff go to Kingsbridge and deliver care than it is to produce it in town.
With the guy that's responsible nationally for the NEARS Care, which is the organisation that runs the service here. And my understanding, Sarah, from that meeting, with the two of you were going to meet and sort that out, he certainly was saying to me that he was more than willing to meet with you to resolve that. Because I personally...
Following our meeting, I've had absolutely no...
Okay, well, I didn't know that, but I will pick that up tomorrow then with him.
That a number of private companies have withdrawn from the area following the movement by Devon of the boundary, putting Dartmouth with Totnes and Torquay and keeping capacity of delivering to the villages the well-needed home care, and at the moment as an organisation we do about 3,000 visits a month, and we are flat out of the waiting list, and in 14 years we've never been in that situation.
Very quickly, we'll just say, because I realise time's pressing, I will just say, we'll sort that out. I didn't know that that hadn't been followed up on, and I'll pick that up tomorrow with you. What I would just repeat is, we have got an assurance from our local domiciliary care provider that from the 4th of June, there will be enough hours to meet all the need that there is in Dartmouth, and with more hours to grow on that, which can give us an opportunity to do some further work as well. And that's where we're working to, so I think we're going to meet all the need. But I will get that picked up tomorrow. I'll deal with the National Director on that.
Pam, here, Pam on the right here. Please, on the right. Pam, you stand up, say who you are, and who you represent.
I'm Jill Bannister. I'm Jill Bannister, and I'm a carer for my husband. I've been a carer on and off for 30 years. I'm in my mid-80s, how much longer can I go on for? I care for my husband all day. I used to belong to quite a number of different organisations in the town. I helped with the flail, and I helped for the swimming pool. But I haven't been to our new swimming pool. I haven't found time.
Jill, can you just give the question that you would like to ask, please?
I'm sorry, there are several points. I would like to know if any of this panel have been to Riverview and have seen how much car parking there is there. Why keep harping on about Riverview? And the people there have got you over a barrel. I'd like to see a care in the community set up somewhere away from Riverview and leave them with that on their hands.
Right, Joe, I think I've got your point. We've got the gist of that. Brilliant. Thank you very much, Liv. Very, very good.
The other night I had to call our neighbours my husband fell. He's 6'4", admittedly now he only weighs 13 stone. He was over 20 stone. He was playing only 4 days a week. I had to call my neighbours to help me lift him from this Saturday evening at 11 o'clock at night. I was very lucky to get some neighbours to come help me lift him. Otherwise, I'd had to phone for an ambulance, and going by my own experience of waiting 6.5 hours 2 years ago, when I had heart condition, the doctor said I had to go to Torbay by ambulance. She wouldn't let my husband take me in the dark. And I waited 6.5 hours. So on a Saturday evening, I thought, no way am I going to get any ambulance men to come and pick my husband up off the floor for me. So that was that. Luckily, my neighbours were home.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dave. Very good. Well done, Liz. Here on.
I don't think, I mean, thanks for telling us your story. That's a very powerful example of why it's important we provide the level of support for carers at home that you need, and you feel described that. And that has to be available 24/7, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to meet your needs. In terms of review, I think we've probably run out of some of those issues, and hopefully we'll be able to move on from that and provide something appropriate.
And the gentleman by the back there who will put his hand up, we're now going to come to the choir stalls, please.
Who's
She's isolated and she's alone and she's in prison. And it's not right and it's not proper. Hospitals, people get better just because there are other people to share their ailments with. And you have failed us all. You have spent all our money on stupid things like foyers at Torbay, massive foyers. The wards, the curtains, everything as scruffy as can be. I was in Torbay very recently. It's pitiful. And you can do a lot better. And the best thing all of you can do is to take massive cuts in salaries and leave us with our cottage hospitals.
Doing nothing, no, we have nothing, except that ambulance, which has got difficulty getting around, particularly in the summer months, we have a road condition, and just off up and the river in the way. Can you tell me how on earth do your commission justify closing the hospitals they have, which are just about as far as you can get from Torbay Hospital?
Dartmouth Hospital is very much a part of our heritage. It inherently
Dartmouth, as many others have said. It cannot be changed into a glossy state-of-the-art model hospital, but is that what is really needed in this town? With careful, thoughtful planning, it could still provide us with 6 beds. It could be updated to provide a better NIU. Within it, we could find multiple uses for the real needs of a town the size of Dartmouth. In fact, with a little imagination, there are many ways to improve all our health facilities and save the NHS money, certainly not in the region of 8 million, mooted to rent 2 floors of Riverview. You have run roughshod over the medical needs of this town. For political purposes, you have taken catastrophic decisions based on flawed data and evidence, and you have simply pushed on through to achieve your goals. We do not support you.
Feel as though the hospital has been closed down
by people who don't live in the town and who are telling us what we want. I suppose my main question is, what difference will tonight make to your decisions?
Candidate who will have the pleasure of standing against Dr. Sarah in a few years.
managed. Can you offer this community, there's a very strong feeling in the room tonight that not everybody wants to rely on care at home. I myself, my husband died of cancer at home, and I know that for me the hospital setting was extremely important in giving me the confidence and knowledge about his care that I needed. I didn't want it all to happen at home, and I think a lot of people would share that. It's a very frightening thing to have to care for someone who's seriously ill in a home environment, you know, put aside all the social aspects of being in hospital. So can you give this community a commitment that there will be beds available in Dartmouth for people who need them and want them at some point in the not too distant future? And I'm not talking 10 or 15 years hence. Can you commit that that is going to be part of your plan for the future healthcare of Dartmouth?
Set that consistently throughout. We're currently in negotiations with a range of providers. As I said right at the very start, we have been able to place people in the Dartmouth area when we needed it. It's not in the sort of arrangement that we would want, because we would rather have block beds so that we can make sure we always meet them, but we have been able to deliver spot purchase when it's being needed. So yes, absolutely, we will have bed-based care available.
Strong word, but I feel we all feel lied to. Yeah. Yeah. or at least deceived, but I actually think it's stronger than that. I think we feel lied to. You promised us that you would not close our community hospital until a new facility was up and running and in place. That's what you promised us. Before that, you promised us that we would not lose our minor interest unit. You then took that office, and then you said, oh, we'll have one during the summer months. That didn't happen either. You promised us to keep our x-ray service here in Dartmouth. That went. You promised us Riverview, and I'm sorry, we don't trust you anymore. I'm really sorry. We've given you enough. Tonight you have promised us beds in the vicinity. You've promised us tonight beds in Dartmouth. Now, I believe I know where those beds are at the present moment. I don't know why you aren't prepared to make it clear to everybody where they are.
Where are they?
To my knowledge, they're in Beacon Court. That's where I understand they're in. Since we're here.
It's full.
People's lives, because of your decisions, are at risk. Dartmouth, okay, it's only 5-6 miles away from Paignton and Brooks and that side. But once our ferry closes at 10:45 or 11, is amazingly cut off. You could be in the middle of Dartmoor. You probably have better connectivity to a hospital if you were in Dartmoor than we have at the present moment. We have a very elderly community, and we have one of the most deprived areas in Dartmouth, but need your help. Well, I mentioned Dartmouth, I didn't want to mention where it is, but we all know where it is, we didn't want to mention that. But we have one of the most deprived areas that need your help, care and assistance. We have very, very poor, bad bus services. Over the years, year on year, those services have been cut. So for these people who have to find a nursing home in Teignmouth or Dawlish, or even go and visit their parent or father or wife or husband in New Navis Hospital, it's near impossible for those people to get to. Really is impossible. You then give us the aspiration that we may have a health and wellbeing centre set up by 2021. No. That is so totally and utterly unacceptable for everyone in this room. It is quite clear by this meeting that Dartmouth and its parishes want the Dartmouth Hospital reopened as soon as possible to be the new health and wellbeing centre for our community. Yeah. I really do hope that you are listening tonight, because we are so totally fed up of being consulted, listened to and ignored. This has got to stop. Now, I would like to make two votes or considerations of tonight. First of all, I think we should have a vote of confidence in you, the Trust, the CCG. Now, does anybody in this room, or actually a vote of no confidence in the CCG. Does anybody in this room support that motion? Yeah. Is anybody, would like to put your hands up, please? Is anybody opposed, vote of no confidence in the CCG? Yeah. Is anybody in this room voting against what the actions of the CCG have been in the last few years? Is anybody happy with that? To vote against a vote of no confidence. Now it's quite clear that some do, but I think that's important. Now for you to rebuild that trust, we as a community would like to ask you to review your actions of the last few years, to review your actions of the closure of our cottage hospital, community hospital, and to do all you possibly can within 14 days to come forward with a process of working with us, the community, on how we're going to achieve a health and wellbeing centre back in this town as fast as possible, with the 6 nursing beds which you have always promised us. I hope everybody will support that. If you do not do that within 14 days, this community will ask the government inspector to review your actions and the handling of this project, including the predetermination and deceit of closing our community hospital.
Under the circumstances, I think you agree. But lots more to do. So, thank you all very much for attending. The gentlemen and the ladies are here if you've got specific questions that you'd like to speak about. Thank you all very much.